I'm your host, Greg Szymanski, and we're here on GCN for 2 solid hours, 4 to 6 p.m. Central. And I'll tell you what, this show has been called the alternative to the alternative media, and that's because we get behind the scenes. And one of the reasons is we try to really uncover who the real spiritual controllers of the New World Order are. And with that, what we do is we don't stop, and we go to basically right to the cobblestones of Rome in the Vatican and explore that issue in depth. I said the other day that if I spent every one of my shows for the next 10 years talking about this subject, it would not equal what really needs to be done to expose the Vatican and what we're going to show today, the evil Jesuit order, because for all the years and the time and the money they have spent to keep this from the American people, right now we are in the crosshairs of a possible destruction. And let me just quote this. This is from a book that Bill Hughes wrote. He's been on my show, and he said this in this book, The Secret Terrorists. The Jesuits have always hated America and everything this country stands for, and they work tirelessly to destroy this country. Now, today my guest, and this is a show that I want you people to listen to for 2 hours because it's vital. I have on with me my special guest is Pastor Gerard Bouffard, and he's a former Catholic priest, a former bishop of Guatemala, and he's in Canada right now. And he's going to talk about the truth about the Catholic Church, about the Vatican, and also bring up, you've heard this name before if you've listened to my show, and this is Father Alberto, the late Father Alberto Rivera, a Jesuit priest who actually told how the Jesuits operate, how they infiltrate other religions, and he was also one of those people, and he began to out the Jesuits in the Vatican, and for that, many people say he was killed. Well, Pastor Bouffard was a friend of Alberto Rivera, and is here to talk about him also, about his past, about his the truthfulness he was trying to tell, in light of many people who said that Alberto Rivera was not telling the truth and was under a campaign of discreditation by the Vatican. Now, my second guest is Eric Phelps, and he's been on my show before because he's one of the premier researchers in this area, and he knows Pastor Bouffard quite well, has interviewed him many times. And in fact, he's going to act as the main interviewer in this. I'm going to be more of a moderator because I want you people to get the full truth. And these two gentlemen together, I think, can shed some light on what we've been trying to show, and that is that the Vatican is the key behind the whole New World Order and the destruction of this country, and they use the Jesuit order as their henchmen, so to speak. And if you go to my website, by the way, today I have an article on there, and I asked the question, was JFK's secret society speech one reason why the Vatican orchestrated his murder? Now, on September 12, 1960, President John F. Kennedy spoke to the Greater Houston Ministerial Association, saying emphatically that no religious leader, including the Pope, had the right to control his actions and influence the foreign and domestic policies of this country in any way, shape, or form. For his strong words in his speech denouncing secret societies and religious infiltration, some researchers of the JFK assassination, including my guest Eric Phelps today, claims this speech set him up for the murder by the Vatican New World Order controllers through the Jesuit order. Now, on my website, it gives a rundown of that speech, and then I list the actual extreme oath, the fourth vow of the Jesuits, which was printed in first published in 1883. And that's the unedited version, so go to that. And you'll see exactly what these higher level Jesuits are now professing, and when they take this fourth vow. Eric knows about it, he's going to talk about it. And with that, Pastor Bouffard's on the line. With that, let me introduce Eric Phelps. Eric, how are you today?
A pleasure to be with you, Greg, and your listeners.
Well, today we're going to spend 2 hours, and we're going to spend 2 hours, and I'm going to rely on your direction, your care, your. I tell you what, you have been looking for the truth for so long, and I'm so glad you brought on the pastor here to verify a number of things. And I think what we should do is have you introduce him properly, because you know him well, and enter into the first questions that you think are important, and I'll be right by your side here throughout these 2 hours. Go ahead.
Okay. I'd like to introduce my friend and guest on your show today, Greg, Pastor Gerard Bouffard. Welcome, Gerard.
Welcome you, Eric, and welcome everyone in here.
A pleasure to have you. Pastor Buffard resides in Quebec, so his native language is French, so he does have a broken accent.
Well, I can understand him pretty well, so don't worry about that.
Okay.
Because I think the message will come through loud and clear. Eric, can you tell us a little bit about his Pastor Buffard's background and lead us up to how you met him?
Okay, when I was in a debate with a couple of gentlemen from England with regard to Alberto Rivera being legitimate or not, I was told of Pastor Buffard by an additional email person, so I contacted him and I asked if I could come to visit him. So I went to visit him a couple of years ago and spent a few days with him, and he showed me his broken bishop's ring that he had when he was Bishop of Guatemala, and his sword from the Knights of Columbus that he had when he was a member of that. And so we traveled around, and he pretty much bore his soul to me. And so after two or three days of spending time with him and his familiarity with Alberto Rivera, I took that as a very important piece of evidence that Alberto was indeed for real. So Gerard has helped me very much in that area, but more so than that, Gerard knows the Lord. He's a born-again, Bible-believing Christian man. He's a pastor. He preaches the Word of God wherever he goes, and he also offers videos. And so he's quite at home in talking about the Lord, the Bible, and his past.
You know, we've got 2 minutes before this first break. I want to get the pastor some questions about Alberto Rivera. You can do that in the next break. I don't think I want to get into it right now. We only have 2 minutes, but maybe you can give us a little background of his, how many years he was in the Catholic Church, and also, I believe he was Bishop of Guatemala, correct?
Yes. I'm not sure the answer to that question. Maybe, Gerard, maybe you'd like to start about your beginnings there as a priest, if you
will. Yes, I was doing my study in Rome because I was an orphan boy, and in the Catholic Church in Quebec, when we are adopted people, you know, we are not allowed to become a priest, but I had to go to Rome to do my study, and I was 6 years in Rome. And to pay my study, I was working in the Vatican. That's why I had that opportunity to work inside the Vatican. And the office, they named that, in this time, they have to name that the Holy Office. In 1983, they changed that for the Office of Protection of the Faith. And I was there. And after that, when the Pope came in, John Paul II came in Mexico for the conference of the Bishop of Latin America, I was traveling with him. And during this traveling, we had a discussion together. And in his way back from Rome, we talked very hardly in the plane. And when I reach Rome, I take the plane and I'm coming back in Quebec. And I get safe and in Quebec, and I leave the church in 1977. And after that, I'm born again, and now I'm serving the Lord in the gospel.
Well, listen, Pastor, I have to take a break right now, and Eric, a 4-minute break, but I want to get back and find out what you learned about the Vatican, why you left the church, and also all these things about Father Alberto Rivera. We'll be back in 4 minutes on the Investigative Journal. Okay, we're back for our first segment. I should say our last segment in the first half hour of the Investigative Journal. My two special guests are former pastor and Catholic priest, former Bishop Gerard Buffard, who lives now in Quebec, in Canada, and Eric Phelps, the author of Vatican Assassins, and his third edition will be coming out shortly, and something that you must get once it's out, because you know something in our quest to get at who are the real spiritual controllers of the New World Order. Pastor Buffard is going to tell you some things, why he left the Catholic Church, also verifying he was a good friend of Father Alberto Rivera, who, if you're not familiar with this former Jesuit priest, talks about how they infiltrate other religions, how the Jesuit order is more than just what they say, God-fearing men, but actually the henchmen behind the New World Order and bringing down the destruction of this country. With that, Pastor, we left off. You've been working in Rome for 6 years, communicated and spoke with the Pope on numerous occasions. And I want to get into why you then left the church in the late 70s. And how I'm going to do this, Eric, you've talked to Pastor for a long time, and I want you to go back and give our listeners an insight and ask the questions that you would have asked when you first met him about why he left the church. And I think through you and him speaking, I think we'll learn a lot. Go ahead.
Okay, I wanted to, first of all, be convinced that he was a former priest. So, Gerard, would you tell us about what your bishop's ring looks like, and when you cease to be a bishop of Guatemala, what do they do with the bishop's ring?
Yes. The bishop's ring is the symbol of the power of the bishop in his diocese. You know, in the bishop ring, just like at the bishop, the pope ring, we have a seal on that. Our diocese seal, and in the past, as 50 years, 60 years ago, every letter was wrote and voiced by the bishop to a priest or to someone in the diocese. Officially, they're supposed to have the seal of the bishop in that, and that ring was. Had the seal of the bishop and the diocese to confirm and wrote official letters, you know, and papers. And that's rings coming from the tradition, you know, because the first bishop and the first popes in the Catholic Church, they was prince or, you know, honorific titles, you know, and the ring was the symbols of the power of the bishop. And when the pope died, by example, they have to broke his ring to destroy the seal, his official seals, and the new pope have to have a new seals, a new symbol for his power. And you put that in the ring. And when I get out of the church, I had different seal, different ring. I had to broke the official one I had, but I conserve already my bishop seal, because this is my, you have a part of my family arms in that seal, you know. That's why I conserve the seal, because this is my property. Nobody else can use it in my place, because that's the personnel seals.
Mm-hmm. Now, how long were you Archbishop in Guatemala, or Bishop of Guatemala? Pardon me.
I was 14 years priest, mm-hmm. and the three last years I was a bishop of Esquipulas in Guatemala, and I was vice president of the Council of the Bishop in Latin America. That's why I had to go to Rome and travel with the Pope in Mexico for the conference with the Bishop of Latin America.
And what languages were you fluent in at that time?
In that time, when I was in Guatemala, I was speaking Spanish, because I was 14 years there. I had to learn the language of the people, but I have to learn 9 different languages in my life.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Uh-huh. And so, English, French, Spanish,
Creole, Korean, Vietnamese, and that's a lot of language. I don't use so much now, because I don't wrote. Before, I had like 100 person I had to wrote every month. But now, you know, I speak I speak English, I speak Spanish, I speak Creole, I speak French too, and When I was missionary in Africa, I have to learn the 5 different languages there too. That's a tribe language, Shona, Nyanja, Matebele, and that's a Zulu's language. When we are missionary, we have to learn different languages to talk with the peoples.
And whereabouts were you in Africa as a priest?
Yeah, I was priest in Rhodesia. Now they changed the name for Zimbabwe. But I was 5 years in Rhodesia in Kutama Mission. I was the parish priest there, and I was the priest for the religious brothers and for the school. I was the serving school with 2,500 students.
Mm-hmm. Were you familiar with Bishop Tutu and possibly his relationship with
the
Jesuits?
He was a Protestant Anglican priest, and I was Catholic priest. We was working in the same place, in the same mission.
Do you know if he was affiliated with Jesuits?
Desmond Tutu was, you know, the Anglican priest, they are not officially friend with the Jesuit, because the Anglican priest, they are considered by the church, Catholic Church, as a Protestant, you know. But the Jesuit, they have their power in the Catholic Church. I realized a few years ago, all the prime minister in Canada, all the president of the big company, and all the prime minister in the province in Canada, in the United States, they was formed at the college by the Jesuit fathers. They was educated by the Jesuit. That's why the Jesuit try to have the control in the world.
Okay, Pastor, I'm going to take a four-minute break, and Eric, we're going to come back. I know you'll have your questions ready again. We'll be back in 4 minutes on the Investigative Journal. Okay, we're going to get right back at it on the Investigative Journal. My two special guests are former Bishop of Guatemala, Gerard Bouffard, who now resides in Canada, and also Eric Phelps, author of Vatican Assassins, who's acting as my co-host and providing some really stimulating questions, because he's known the pastor for a long time, the bishop, and we're getting, we just finished. I want to pick up right where we left off, and that was we established the bishop's role as a priest. The number of years he worked in the Vatican as a confidant also to the Pope, and then also his experience as a bishop of Guatemala and over in Africa. So go ahead, Eric, pick up where you left off.
Okay, he was a bishop in Guatemala, and he was a priest for many years in Africa, and knew 9 languages. Gerard, when I visited you, you showed me your sword of the Knights of Columbus. Could you tell me a little bit about the Knights of Columbus and what your oath, and are you a fourth degree? Were you a fourth degree Knight of Columbus?
Knights of Columbus, that's for normally that's for the Catholic peoples. They have four degrees. Normally, the people they take 3 degrees, and after that, when they have the money and they want to be in charge and have more power, they go to New Haven to receive the fourth degrees.
New Haven, Connecticut.
The fourth degrees, that's just symbolic, you know, but the Knights of Columbus, now in Quebec, they lose a lot of their powers, you know. Before, they was like a guard, like a soldier for the church, and taking honor when the bishop was visiting a parish, something like that. But now, they do a social thing, you know. They collect money to help the poor people, and they are going slowly, you know, down.
Mm-hmm. I see.
This time, they was powerful. When we was arrested by the police, by example, you just do the sign, and if the police was the Knight of Columbus, you know, they say, I don't give you a ticket, but be careful, next time, you know, I have to give you a ticket. When a Knight of Columbus have to go to court, by example, he do a sign, a special sign to the judge, and they arranged that because he was a brother, you know.
Mm-hmm. What is the relationship of the Knights of Columbus to the Jesuits?
Oh, the Knights of Columbus and the Jesuit, the Ignatius of Loyola found the Jesuit to check the church. You know, the general superior of the Jesuit order, we call him the Black Pope. He's the one running the church in the background, you know,
so you think
in the shadow.
So the Black Pope really runs the Vatican.
And that's why the Jesuit order tried to take the secret orders inside of the Catholic system to have more control in the church, in the public, in the company, and in the world. The infiltrate the world by secret orders, you know, like a Knife of Columbus, Freemasonry, Carbonaries, and that's all come from Illuminati's organization, you know, to organize the world government.
And so, if I just may add something here, Eric, while I'm listening, what I'm hearing from you, Pastor, is that the Jesuits behind the scene, through the Black Pope, actually control the Vatican, correct?
Yes. They are controlling the Vatican. You just like the things the Pope says last week, normally the Jesuits suppose each sermon the Pope suppose, or each conversation the Pope have to do in public, they have to check that because they don't accept the Pope do some error, some mistake, you know. And they didn't check is what he says, and you know what is the impact of his last sermon in Germany, you know, mm-hmm. against the Muslim and everything. That's because the Jesuit, they never check his preach.
Mm-hmm.
The Jesuit, they supervise everything in the church. Nothing go out if it's not supervised by the Jesuit.
Now, you learned this from your days in Rome, correct?
Yes, because when I was working, I was a rector of the Holy Office in Rome. I had to contact the Jesuit every day, and I was in charge of the secret document in the Vatican, in the Holy Office, and I was not allowed to send out any document before that document was checked by a Jesuit, by a Jesuit priest. You know, they have to supervise everything. They run the church secretly. That's why we call their superior the Black Pope, you know.
Well, amazing.
He's the shadow of the Pope.
Shadow of the Pope. You told me, Gerard, that you'd also been, while you were a priest, you'd also been brought into the Masonic Lodge. You were also a Mason. Could you tell us about that and the degrees that you were?
I was in 37 degrees. Yes, in the Masonry. First of all, I had the 33 first degrees. I was a priest, normal priest. But when I came in charge in the Vatican, you know, from the first degree to the 33 degrees, that's normal people. 34, 35, 36 degrees. They are the elders of the great company, multinational company like Air Canada, traveling company, banks, big like a Ford company in the United States, Chrysler. They are in the 36 degrees. In 37 degrees, they are all member of the clergy. Roman Catholic, Jews, Protestant, Hindu, Muslim, they are all in the 36, 37 degrees. They are all from religious.
So would you say that all the high priests in the papacy, as well as the high Protestants like Billy Graham and the high Muslims like the El-Saud dynasty and the high Jews, the high Jewish chief rabbis, would you not say that the majority are all Masons?
No, not the majority of them, but each religion, they had to have a representant in the Freemasonry degree, in 36, 37 degrees. 38 degrees, they are more closer, you know. We don't know at 37 degrees who is in the 38 degrees. And the top is 39 degrees. And, you know, Freemasonry, they work with two pyramids. One in North America and one in Europe. Mm-hmm. And the 38 degrees, they are two peoples. One from North America pyramid and the other from European pyramid. And the 39 degrees is the supreme chief of the Freemasonry. And the last chief I know was Paul VI, the Pope Paul VI. He was the only pope, and all the story of the church, you know, his hat is supposed to have three crowns. That's why they call that in Latin tiara. That means three crowns. But Paul VI had four crowns, because the fourth one was the war chief of the Freemasonry.
Okay, we're going to take a break and come back with former Bishop Bouffard and Eric Phelps. And I might remind everyone that in canon law, it's supposed to mean excommunication if you belong to a Masonic lodge. We'll be back and talk about that in 4 minutes.
Now you can do something.
Okay, we're back for the final segment of this first hour of the Investigative Journal, and we're going to spend 2 hours with my guests. That's former Bishop Gerard Bouffard and also Eric Phelps, author of Vatican Assassins. And I hope people out there appreciate this, former Bishop Bouffard is saying. A person that has this kind of information, who worked closely in Rome and understands the inner workings, should be praised for coming forward, because I'll tell you what, not many people do. This has been a long kept secret in this country of actually the real workings of the Vatican, what their real intentions are, and how they use the Jesuit order as their henchmen. And I think after this interview, go to www.gcnlive.com, go to the archives, pass this around, because I think after you listen to these 2 hours, it will remove any kind of doubt that the Vatican is actually the religious controllers of the New World Order, controlled by the Black Pope. And we have former Bishop Gerard Bouffard, who has verified that after working in the Vatican for a number of years, communicating with the Jesuits on a daily basis. Eric, I want you to continue. It was shocking to me to hear this about all these different... I knew back in the 80s when I worked in Rome, I was there when over 150 high bishops, priests, and our cardinals were outed as being members of Masonic lodges, P2 included. I remember the story coming out in the Vatican, in the Italian newspapers when I worked there. And now we hear that Pope Paul VI, through Bishop Bouffard's recollections, was actually a 39th degree Mason. Unbelievable. Go ahead and pick it up from there, Eric. Are you there?
Yes, I am there.
Go ahead.
You know what I says. I says, you know, I don't say the brother Billy Graham or he was missing, but I says, you know, the Jesuit, they infiltrate the Christian church, but through the Mason, they infiltrate the big organization, like a Baptist organization, Baptist Church, Pentecostal Church, Adventist Church. They infiltrate the big system to control the system. And many of their pastor or their leaders, they don't know they are infiltrated by the Jesuit through the secret orders, you know. The secret orders, they are created to infiltrate the people and to know what is going inside the heart of each organization to control, to make that's a world government, you know, That's their way to control. They infiltrate the church, they infiltrate the congregation, and they know everything is going inside. And mm-hmm. with that they can play their card and they organize their thing, you know.
That leads to another question.
Go ahead, Eric.
What do you feel, Pastor Buffard, is the purpose for the confessional that the priests employ?
The what? The confession?
Yeah, why are they using... What's the real reason for the confessional? What are they doing with...
Okay. The priests, they confess... Now, they don't use that because the people, they don't believe in that. Before, just like me, while I was named a priest in Africa or in Guatemala, I don't know what I had to preach because I don't know the sins of the people. And we have to preach against the sins of the people and to know who are the sins of the people. We have to receive a confession from them. They come in confessional, they accuse my father, I do this. Okay, in the name of God, I forget your sins, in the name of the Father, the Son, and all the ghosts. We give them a punishment and they go. But next Sunday, I said, oh yes, in this parish, they do adultery. They drink a lot. They are wrong against their wife. They don't look after their family. And I have something to preach. That's why they use confession. That's why now the Catholic Church, they lose the power in their people because the people, they don't know. They don't go in confession again. They are not obliged to go. When I was priest, we was obliged to go in confession every week. Because if you don't go to confession, we are not allowed to receive the communion. And if we don't receive the communion, the people in church, they say, she don't receive the communion because she do something wrong. To don't be judged by the people, we have to go to confessional to receive the absolution, and after that receive the communion. That's a control system organized by the church to know the private life of the people.
Mm-hmm. As you say these things, it reminds me that, see, Lyndon Johnson, he wanted to have communion from his Roman Catholic priest, Father Schneider. And Father Schneider said, I can't give you communion until you're baptized. Isn't that correct?
I don't hear your question well.
Okay, a Catholic priest cannot give communion to the person unless the person is baptized into the Catholic Church, right?
Yeah, he's not supposed to give a communion if you are not baptized.
Okay, and I found it very humorous that when I read this particular document that Lyndon Johnson, the American president involved in the assassination of John F. Kennedy, that he wanted to take communion from the man he called his best friend, Father Winibar Schneider. And Father Winibar Schneider, who was the pastor of Francis Xavier Church in Texas, said, I cannot give you communion because you're not baptized.
But the President Kennedy, all I hear in his story, he was a Catholic president. He was Roman Catholic president.
Yes, he was a Roman Catholic. But with President Kennedy, he would not allow the Sunday Mass to be said in the White House.
Yeah, I don't know, but I know. For us, he was a Catholic president in the United States. But you know, is each bishop, each priest, they do what they want in their parish. If I want to refuse a communion to certain peoples, I was allowed to do this, you know. But, you know, in each religion, they have a special law, and they have a common law, and they can change the law as they want, you know.
Yeah. But, okay. You mentioned Paul VI. Before he was Pope Paul VI, he was the Assistant Cardinal Secretary of State for Pius
XII. Yeah, he was Secretary of State. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you familiar with his involvement in the Vatican rat lines helping Nazis escape out of Europe after World War II?
You know, the World War II, that's a big story.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big money story. You know, the Church of Rome, the Vatican, the Bank of the Vatican, they had a problem, and they asked the Jews banks, the world Jews banks, to refill the bank, you know. But they had the date to give the money back, you know. That's the main story, but you know, they have some document to prove that, you know, but that's difficult to prove, but the normal story is, and because the Vatican didn't have the money to give the money back to the Jews bank, the Pius XII and his council, he was a new pope in this time, he asked Van Patten and Alfred Müller, the guards and the counselor of Hitler, to come in Rome, and he said, we have to kill the Jews because the Jews put Jesus on the cross. But that's not the Jews made Jesus on the cross. First of all, that's a Roman, the soldier of Rome, to kill him. But Jesus was made on the cross because of my sins, not because of the Jews.
Pastor, we're going to have to take a break, and Eric, we're going to take a top-of-the-hour break, about 3 minutes, and then 6 minutes for news. So both of you take a little breather. We're going to come back for our second hour on the Investigative Journal with Eric Phelps, author of Vatican Assassins, and former Bishop Gerard Bouffard. Back in about 7 minutes. Okay, we're back for the second hour of the Investigative Journal. My guests are former Bishop of Guatemala, Gerard Bouffard, who also worked a number of years in the Vatican and has inside information that he has shared with us that first hour. My other guest is also Eric Phelps, the author of Vatican Assassins, and we're together questioning who are the real spiritual controllers of the New World Order. And I want to thank Bishop Gerard Bouffard for coming forward with this information. And we're going to continue on. I know, Eric, are you there right now?
Yes.
Something's can we get the music off in the back? Thanks. What I wanted to mention, Eric, was that there's some things I'd like to get at with the... I know you know the bishop quite well. There's some things I think I'm interested in is why he finally left. I'd like to get into that, why he left the church. Also, the state of the church in America and the Jesuit role here. And I just thought you might want to pick it up again where you left off.
Okay. Well, Gerard, tell us... why you left the papacy and how you came to the Lord?
Oh, I was coming from Rome and a boy came in front of me in a railway station in Montreal and asked me if I was saved. But I can't answer because I didn't know what that means, save, salvation, you know. And the boys told me, he said, if you find a Bible, you know if you are saved or not. And finally, I find a Bible, and I open the Bible in the books of Hebrew, chapter 7, verse 23, 24, and 27. That verse said, and they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, that means Jesus, because he continued ever, had an unchangeable priesthood. And in French, that means not transmittable priesthood. That means that priesthood of Jesus can be given to anyone. That's specially for him. And verse 27, he said, needed no daily as those high priests to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins and then for the people. For this he died once when he offered up himself at the cross. That means after Jesus is no more priest. I was believing the Bible was the words of God, but first of all, I was not allowed to read the Bible. And secondly, I didn't have to read the Bible because I was some more intelligent at the Bibles. In the church, the Catholic Church, they don't preach through the Word of God. They preach the Word of St. Thomas of Aquin. They preach through theology, philosophy, and, big preacher, but they use the Bible just to face, you know. And when I read that verses, you know, I was shocking in myself, and I said, I'm not a priest, who I am. And that, from that moment, I get out of the church, and I find some Christian, and they preach me the Word of God, and I accept Jesus Christ in my life. I give my life to Jesus, and I consecrate in my life, and I'm serving him up to now. And the first, I have few points, you know, I find when I was reading the Bible, you know, the Holy Spirit opened my eyes and teach me something. The Catholic Church, you know, they practice idolatry. They adore people.
Idolatry.
And the Bible said you're supposed to adore God only, you know. And they continue with the priesthood. But according in the Word of God, is no more priesthood. And in the Bible, you can't find priesthood anywhere in the New Testament. They speak about the prophets, the evangelists, the apostles, the pastors, the teachers, but they never speak about priests again because we have only one priest, Jesus Christ, you know. And they have intercession with the dead. And the Bible said we're not supposed to obey the people. They have contact with the dead, with the spirit of the dead. The Bible said no to that. And the Catholic Church, when they say the Mass, they practice witchcraft with the dead people. They pray Mary, they pray St. Joseph, they pray that saint, all dead people. And we have a living God. We're supposed to pray Jesus. Jesus said, all thing you ask to my Father in my name, you receive it, you know. We have one God. And we adore and we pray. They push us to pray the dead people, and we have a living God, but they don't worry about him. That's the more crime the Catholic institution do. They play with the spirit. For the priest, when he said the Mass, is obliged to have a stone. A stone with, in the middle of that stone, they have a little tomb with the bones of the dead in there. If the priest can't put his cup in that, the Mass is not good. You have to pass by the spirit of the dead to have good things. That's not what the Word of God says. Eh? We have a living God, and he's only one mediator between Jesus, between the Father and us, is Jesus.
Now, I got to ask you a question. When you were at the Vatican, Bishop, when you worked there for all those years, there are many people that say the high-level Jesuits, the hierarchy of the Vatican, actually their first allegiance is to Lucifer. Looking back at your experience, can you add anything to that statement?
About the Jesuit power?
No, about... Go ahead. I was saying the Jesuits, many people say the Jesuits and the hierarchy, the high Vatican priests, many of them have their first allegiance to Lucifer, not to Jesus. What do you think?
That's true. If you look at the story of the church from now to the beginning, you know, a religion You can't find any religion you want. Inside of the religion, they have witchcraft. And by the witchcraft, they control people. They control the soul of the people. That's why when we give our life to Jesus Christ, when we confess Christ as our personal Savior, we ask Him to put outside of ourselves all spirit. Many people, they are kidnapping by the spirit of witchcraft and all that's coming from the power. And to face that, they organize a secret organization. And, but they are all controlled by the high priest in the Catholic Church or other religion, you know. They are member of the, they are coming from that religion, but they stay. They are afraid, they are in war against their mother, but they stay the daughter of their mother. They use the same way, but different manners, you know. That's why I myself, I'm not a Protestant. I am part of the body of Christ. I am a Christian, born-again people. I'm not a Protestant. When you call you Protestant, because you are not born again. We have to leave everything in that.
The vast majority of Protestants are high-level Freemasons. The Southern Baptist Convention has 500,000 Masons in their convention.
Yeah.
Eric, we're going to have to take a break right now. Pastor and Eric, we're going to take a break right now. Be back in 4 minutes and continue on the Investigative Journal. Okay, we're back. Final segment in this half hour of the Investigative Journal, and we're talking with my two guests, former Bishop Gerard Bouffard, who was an insider who worked at the Vatican many years, and also Eric Phelps, author of Vatican Assassins, and that book's coming out shortly, so I want to, at the end of the interview and the next way at the top of the hour, we're going to get into that. But before I do, let me just recap a few things here. The Bishop has come forward telling some shocking things about the Church. He worked in the Vatican for many years, how he learned on a daily basis that the Jesuit order through the Black Pope actually controlled the Vatican, how the Vatican practices witchcraft in its basically in its worshiping, and they actually don't worship God, but to many of the hierarchy worship Lucifer. I wanted to ask, I know Eric has a number of questions, and in the second, right after this segment, I want to spend the last half hour talking about how you knew Father Alberto Rivera, and he's a Jesuit priest who came forward and talked about how the Jesuits infiltrate other religions, how their main goal is to take over this country and other countries and form one world government, one world religion, not under freedom and democracy and worshiping God, but under fascism and basically worshiping Lucifer. And this is going to be an interesting half hour. But let's finish up here, Bishop. I know you left the Church with a bad taste in your mouth, and you were very displeased. Tell us again, when you were at the Vatican, what did you really learn, I mean, about their intentions, about this country, about America?
Greg, I think maybe before we go to that question, it might be good to ask Gerard about, can we please explain to us the doctrine of the temporal power?
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. The doctrine of the temporal power, that's one of the first official secret organization was found by the Templar to control every traffic between Europe to Jerusalem. They call them the protector of the the travelers, you know, the pilgrim, you know, to Jerusalem, but they had to control everything coming inside of Jerusalem and going outside of Jerusalem. And that's one of that reason Ignatius of Loyola found the Jesuit, because the Jesuit had two functions. He was soldier, inquisitor, and to cover that, he was a priest. And as a priest, nobody had a doubt about them. They was believing them. And that gave him the power to take the control. Because in this time, Rome wanted to have the power in Jerusalem and the Holy Land. And they didn't have it. That's why they have the Concordia with the Muslim. You know, Mahomet was married with a Roman Catholic woman.
Mahomet was married to a Roman Catholic woman.
He was married with the Roman Catholic woman. And all that, all the Jesus spirit tried. And Alberto Rivera, when Alberto Rivera get out of the Jesuit order, he started to give his testimony, and he was very, very, very shocking the Catholic system, and he was breaking, really, the faith of the people. That's why the Jesuit order and the Catholic system, they work against him all his life to kill him, to stop him to reveal secret things to the people, you know. That's why they made a war against him, and they kill him too. He was poisonous, poisoned in one hospital, and he was poisoned with acid. You know, they gave him a glass of acid, burned off his body. Alberto died like a martyr. I visited him a few days before he died. I was not there, but I was there a few weeks before he died, and I visited him in hospital. And then I never see a man suffering like that in my life. You know, he gave his life for the truth, but he was blocking to tell the truth, because in the Christian way too, we have some problem too. You know, we still sinner. We are saved, but we still sinner. And he had a problem with the Catholic system when the Jesuit, because he was a Jesuit, and the Jesuit, the things they do to many people against him, then they said he was never a priest, and never was a Jesuit. They break his paper, just like they do with me, you know. They destroy every proof they have. He have, you know, and to break his work, and when they realize they can't stop him to speak, they kill him. That's all.
And you knew Father Rivera,
system, you know.
You knew Father Rivera well, right?
Oh yes, I know him. I know personally. I traveling many times with him to all in the United States. We went to California. We went to Florida. He came in Alberta, in Canada. I was with him. I met him in Alberta when he came for the first time, gave his testimony in a town named Dallas in Alberta, and I met him there. And, you know, I was wrote a letter before to ask the bishop to kill him, you know, when I was in power, because he was really breaking the system.
Did you repeat that, Bishop?
I said I wrote a letter before to the bishop around the world to put Alberto Rivera in the manner of he can't do anything against the church. That means kill him if you want, but stop him to talk.
And this is before when you were still loyal to the Catholic Church, correct?
Yeah. When I was in the Holy Office.
So when I
was born again, I tried to meet him, to talk with him, to ask him to forget me about that. And I met him in Alberta. And after that, we still working together a few years, and we're traveling together with his wife, with his young son, Albertito, and I know perfectly Nuri too, his wife, and we was working together. He came in my town in Quebec to give his testimony in small church where I was pastor, few years ago, and he came in Quebec City to give his testimony in Quebec at the university.
Bishop,
Bishop,
we're going to take a break and then come back in 4 minutes and continue on the Investigative Journal. Okay, we're back, and I'm interviewing, along with Eric Phelps, we're interviewing Bishop Gerard Bouffard, former Bishop Gerard Bouffard, who has left the Catholic Church. Just an incredible story. And Bishop, do you believe what Father Alberto Rivera said about the Jesuit order, their intentions, and the Vatican are true?
Yes, it's true. And you know, in the time of Paul VI, the Vatican was realized that the United States of America was the model for all the country around the world to have a Christian people. We never can find around the world a number of Christian and believers like you had in the United States in this time. That's why Paul VI came to your United Nations to speak there, organize a revival in the Catholic Church, to bring the Catholic Church back to him, you know, to fight the Christian preaching in the United States. John Paul II again come in Mexico to do the same thing, to stop the Christian to take the place of the Catholic Church in Central America, to preach the Word of God and chase that church, you know, that idolatry, you know, church. That's why they come to break, because he was feeling like, you know, the church was going down, and they take their pope to make a revival, Catholic revival. But we know, according in the Bible, we're supposed to have a revival in Quebec, in Canada, in the United States, and to bring our people to God, not to religion. That's why the two last pope, they try to bring the people back to the religion. But the Word of God said we don't have to be religious. We have to be part of the body of Christ and born again and serve God, not serve a religion of Jesuit or secret organization.
Father Alberto Rivera said that the Jesuits in America, he was privy to information that they infiltrated other churches to destroy the religions, to destroy this country, and actually have much power over our government. Do you also believe that from what you've learned?
Yes, I believe that. Because Alberto, the first time, he was an infiltrator. After that, God talked with him, and he changed his mind. That's why they destroy him. Because he never do what they want him to do for them. You know,
right.
He changed his mind and he born again, get converted and start to preach the word of God and speak against the devil system, you know.
Were you there?
Kill him.
Go ahead, Eric.
Were you there?
And I believe that.
Were you there when Alberto spoke in Guatemala, when he spoke to all those people that time, when he exposed the papacy and the purpose of the Jesuits?
Yes, I was there.
You were there. You heard that speech.
Yeah. Oh, yes. And we had the fun after that. Huh?
Mm-hmm. Would you agree with Alberto that the Vatican killed John F. Kennedy, because Alberto was very boisterous about that? In fact, he said he was involved in the assassination of Corpus Christi, Texas. Would you agree
I believe in that too, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes.
About
you know, they can do anything. You can imagine the way they use to destroy.
Would you say that, as Alberto said, that the Vatican was in control of the mafia here in the United States?
Anywhere around the world.
So it's
they control everything. They have the power.
Yeah.
And
ahead,
you know,
questions.
Anyway, with the story of the World Trade Center and everything, you know, the people cannot imagine what they do, you know. The Jesuit system, they control the Catholic Church, they control everything.
So, as I say in my book, and I've said publicly for the last 5 years, that the Jesuits used Archbishop Edward Cardinal Egan to bring down the World Trade Center. Would you agree that the Vatican was really behind the bringing down of the World Trade Center?
You know,
I don't want to answer that, but anyway,
I know where that things come, you know, and I know one thing in the Jesuit system and the secret system or organization system, they try to put United States down because you can't find the majority of the Christian in North America, they are in United States, and that's not what the Catholic and the Jesuit system want. They want control everything. That's why they are against North America.
Would you say that the Vatican is behind all this, all these illegal Mexican Roman Catholic aliens coming into this country by the millions?
Why not?
Yeah. Okay.
You know, you can't imagine all the way they use to destroy and control.
And the directions come from the Black Pope.
Yeah. Yes.
Do the Jesuits control Quebec?
No, it didn't. They are around 15 powerful people in Vatican. They are all Jesuit. They have the Jesuit before they have the Dominican fathers, and the Jesuit take the place of the Dominican after that. They fight against the Dominican because the Dominican, they create the Inquisition, and the Jesuit take the place of the Dominican. And because there is many steps to be a Jesuit, and they are drilled to control and get the control to organize the world government. That's the plan of the secret society, to create the world government, and the Jesuit, they are the head of that.
What do you say?
The Jesuit, they are coming rightly from the Illuminatis.
The Illuminati
system.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of Ignatius Loyola's spiritual exercises?
You made me to laugh. You know what means Jesuit?
No.
Hypocrite.
Hypocrite.
Mm-hmm. And you have your answer. Jesuit means hypocrite. If you look in the dictionary, they wrote Jesuit hypocrites.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, that's an English word is Jesuitical. So if someone is being hypocritical or lying or deceptive, they use the word Jesuitical, at least for a long time. They don't use it much anymore.
Ooh.
And, Pastor, do you ever fear, Bishop, do you ever fear any repercussions for you coming forward? I want to thank, you know, you're so brave to do this, but do you ever fear anything?
You know, I have my family, and it's something, you know, we are Czech, because if we don't, just like Alberto gave his life for that.
Okay, we're going to take a break, come back with our final segment and some important questions remaining. And thank you so much, Bishop. We'll be back in 4 minutes on the Investigative Journal. Okay, we are back for our final 11-minute segment of the Investigative Journal. A fascinating show, one that you need to get. Go to www.gcnlive.com. Go to their archives and pass this around. Now, I got one question for the former bishop and the former bishop who worked inside the Vatican for 6 years. And then, Eric, I know you have a few more. But let me preface it with this. From the beginning of his presidency, George Bush has been promoting the Jesuit agenda, and I think we can prove this beyond a reasonable doubt. Look at this. 2 months into his presidency, surrounded by the cardinals of Rome, the president dedicated a cultural center in Washington, D.C. to the greatest enemy. I think many people who address this issue, like Eric Phelps and the bishop, will agree. The greatest enemy this republic ever had, the Pope of Rome. Bush declared that day that he is going to enforce the words and teachings of the Pope here in America.
That's right.
My last question, Bishop, is when are the American people going to wake up? And what is going to happen to this country if we do not address this issue of this Vatican-led takeover of our country and using the Jesuits here, who have a stronghold with 28 universities? What do they have planned, and why aren't the Americans really responding?
You know, for any people around the world, you know, we are already in the system trying to destroy all the system around the world. We have only one thing to do, and go in our knees and pray God to help and take the control of the world. You know, I don't want to put my nose in the outside of my country, but I know one thing. If the world continues just like it is now, we are going to be destroyed, you know, and we are going to perish. But if we trust God, we're trusting in God and praying essentially and have a contact with God, God loves his people because he created his people. He created the United States, he created Canada, he created everything. We have to go in our lead and pray God to protect us against all the system trying to destroy us. You know, God all the people, many people, the majority of the people, they are religious, but they are not Christian. Any religious system can save people. Any religion around the world, they can save people. We have to faith God, and we have put our faith in Jesus and God, not in the religion. If we are religious, we are not in the end of the Lord. God don't want us to be religious. He want to be his children.
Right.
That's why we have to fight against religion, against all religious system. That the religious system is condemning the people now to death.
Right. And Eric, I know you have some questions. Go ahead. We have about 8 or 9 minutes.
Yeah, so you would say, Pastor Bafar, that for this to change, men have to repent, have their sins, and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that he died for their sins, according to the scriptures, that he was buried.
That's the only way.
And
that's
then
the only hope we can have.
Yes. And then once we would do that, then the Lord would intervene for us, wouldn't you say?
Well, what'd you say?
Once we would truly repent and believe on Christ and then seek the Lord and pray to him, then don't you think he would fight for us and help
us? Yes, God fight for us, and we are already, we have the victory when we really put our life in the hand of God. We are sure to be safe and protect. God is loving his people. You know, I love my family. I love you, brother. I love the other brother in the radio. I love every people in North America. But God loves them more as I love them. He gave his life for them. He gave his life for me. He gave his life for you, brother, precious brother. And we have to put our hand in his, our life in his hand, confess him and serve him, and he's there for protect us.
You know, I'm reminded that that's what happened in England. When the people of England truly, many of them repented and believed on Christ, and the Vatican was using Philip II of Spain to send this huge armada against England. And because they went into their churches and they prayed and they sought the Lord, and then they went out to fight with the armada, that the Lord intervened for them and blew most of the armada up in the North Sea and destroyed at least one third to three quarters of it. 20,000 men on probably 100 Spanish galleons, and only 20 galleons returned to Spain. So if the Lord did it back in England, He can do it again here, because we do anticipate.
Yes, you know, we have one thing to do. Pray for our government. We have to pray for our leaders, our president, our premier minister. We have to pray for our politicians. You know, we have to pray for them.
Well, you know, that reminds me of Charles V. He was the Holy Roman Emperor in the 1500s. And he was greatly persecuting God's people and the reformers and others. And so they all prayed against
but,
him.
But, you know, Jesus said we have to be persecuted, you know, if you want to.
Yeah, we're going to have persecution, no doubt. But they prayed that the Lord would intervene. And you know what Charles V did? Charles V resigned. And he went into a monastery and spent the rest of his life harvesting flowers. Now, that would be a wonderful thing for George Bush. Would to God that he would resign, go into a monastery, and pick flowers for the rest of his life. Because if something like that doesn't happen, he is going to bring the power of the Vatican, its military power, in control of China, Russia, Mexico, the Islamic world, he's going to bring all that over here for our invasion. And I really believe we need to be serious, as the English were, and as you were, Pastor, when you left the power of the Vatican as a bishop. And I would also like to say thank you for telling me that you asked Alberto to forgive you for writing that letter against him.
Yeah, I mean, that is an amazing story. I followed Alberto Rivera's story, and to listen to you, Bishop, give it credibility. I hope everyone out there that's doubted that, and I've had people after I've written the story send me emails, oh, he was never a priest. And I think what this interview has done, I think listeners, you must understand that this comes from the heart of a man who was close to the Catholic Church, who believed in it, and found out their real intentions. And that intention is to destroy us. And we can't let that happen. And we can't let our beliefs, our false beliefs, go on any longer. And that's why I believe what Eric has called for in his book, to oust the Jesuits from this soil, even though they have such a strong foothold, is something that Americans must consider, because they control the Council on Foreign Relations.
That's right.
They control our government, and our government is not representing the people. They're going to what? They are going to preside over the deaths of millions of Americans, and I really thank the bishop for coming forward, because I think it's going to save some lives just by people listening to the credibility of his words. Despite the campaign that the Jesuits, I know, will put on to discredit him, I won't believe it, one word of it, and I hope you out there won't either. Any last words, Pastor or Eric? We only have a couple minutes.
Go ahead, Gerard, please.
Okay. I put the United States in my prayer every day. I put the government, I put President Bush and his elders, to turn their heart to God, you know. God is our only hope. He's the one can give peace, you know. And thank you, Father, to give us this opportunity to be in radio today.
And thank you so much,
Pastor.
Speak
about your love.
With that, I must go. We're all out of time. Eric, thank you so much for coming on board.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you, Gerard, for coming.
God bless you. Lord
bless. Okay, God bless you all. And we're all out of time today on the Investigative Journal. Powerful show. We'll be back tomorrow with another.